Hello, in this video I'm going to be going through my top 10 favourite TV shows, just like the video that I did before on this, but that video was all American TV shows. So it was shows that are created in America, set in America, that type of thing. So this video is going to be my English TV shows and also then just, I guess, international TV shows. So just TV shows that are set somewhere else in the world, that's not America. I am from the UK, so I do watch a few English TV shows. So let's just get right into my list of top 10 international TV shows that I've watched. Now, I did actually find this list quite hard to make, as I think I've definitely seen a lot of English TV shows, because I mean, I'm English, I grew up in England, but I think I just forgot a lot of them because I think I watched a lot of them when I was a child or a teen and I've just forgotten. So I've tried my best. I have got 10, but yeah, it was actually really hard to fill this list. So let's get into it. But before that, I just want to mention some honorable mentions, some ones that I remembered kind of after I'd made the list. And these are like comedy shows, which I really enjoy. I really love comedy TV shows and enjoy comedy, but I do find I just resonate with more serious stuff and dramas a bit more. So a lot of these that didn't make the list are comedy shows, and these are This Country, Misfits, and Gavin and Stacey, all shows that I really like and enjoy, but they just did not make the top 10 this time, unfortunately. But going into the top 10, at number 10, we have the show Waterloo Road.
Welcome to Waterloo Road. I mean, you say you're up for a challenge.
Have you any idea what we're dealing with at Waterloo Road? 22 of our kids are on ASBOs.
Quiet, please!
So we've got the highest underage pregnancy rate in the whole country.
Why is everything going belly up?
The children here don't really like being regimented.
Now, Waterloo Road was a show that I watched as a child and a teen. It was a show that was shown. Waterloo Road is a show that was around in the 2000s, so I believe it started in 2006 or something and then would have finished 2015 or something. And Waterloo Road is about a school. It is about a school where it's just crumbling apart, basically. The students are really naughty, the teachers are also sometimes up to no good, and it's just about a really dysfunctional school. And this is such a beloved show for me. I loved watching this every Thursday with my mum at, I want to say 8 p.m, but it might have been 9 p.m, and then going to school the next day and talking to my friends about it because we all watched it and talking about, oh my god, did you see what happened in yesterday's episode? But Waterloo Road was very much, I would say it was like a soap, and it was very much a show that in every episode they would explore certain themes, and it was quite good that these themes were things that young people could experience, and also older people, as they did do plot lines with the teachers as well, but there'd be things that young people experience maybe in school or outside of school. So they'd cover things like bullying, teenage pregnancy, mental health, immigration. Like, there'd be so many things, because this show did run for a long time. Like, there were so many topics covered, and it was sometimes funny and sometimes sad. And yeah, I just really, really love Waterloo Road. It holds such a special place in my heart. I really, really loved it. I really, really enjoyed it. And they have actually brought it back. The BBC have brought it back, and they've started a new series. And I watched like the first 3 episodes and I hate it. It's just not, I don't know, it just doesn't feel like the old Waterloo Road for me. And I think also I'm probably just too old. I'm probably just too old to watch a show like this that is a soap about a secondary school. But yes, I love Waterloo Road, and yeah, I'll forever love it. I think it was a very good show and also important for young people to watch at that time as well. Next on the list, we have the show Elite.
La pólvora se junta con el fuego.
Solo puede pasar una cosa. Explota.
Boom.
¿Quién fue?
No sé. Esto no es un puto juego. ¿Tienes alguna pregunta más?
Now, Elite is one that I watched on Netflix, and it is actually a Spanish show. So in the show, they all speak Spanish, and I do believe there was a bit of controversy with this show. I think people weren't happy with some of the representation that was in this show, which is not something that I ever really picked up on, just because it was representing things that I don't know much about. So I think people were unhappy with the Muslim representation and stuff like that. So I can't really speak on that. And that's kind of why the show is only number 9 on this list, because of all the things I've heard about it. But when I watched Elite, which I think it's still going, by the way, and I'm not up to date, I'm purely talking about the first 3 seasons, maybe 4. I can't remember if I watched the 4th. I feel like I did. I do want to watch the rest and finish it because I do like it, but I just haven't yet. But the first 3 seasons, at least, I loved it. I thought it was so fun. I loved the characters. It was intriguing. But essentially, what Elite is, it is about a school in Spain. It is about a private school in Spain. And these 3 non-private school kids join the school because their old school collapsed. So as kind of like compensation, they're like, oh, we'll take your brightest students and or some of your brightest students and put them in our private school for free. And essentially these 3 kids join the school, and this causes a lot of drama, as a lot of these rich people are not very nice and don't want to share their school. And then there's a murder, and essentially season 1 follows someone's been murdered, and you're spending the whole season trying to work out who did it, essentially. And then in season 2, there's another murder, and then I can't remember if there's another murder in season 3, I'm not sure. But I loved season 1. I thought it was so good. I loved the characters. Like, I really enjoyed getting to know the characters. I found it intriguing. I didn't know who had done it. Also, this show is a bit sexual. There's quite a few sexual scenes, which were not my favorite, just because, like, I'm like, this is fine, but I think maybe Elite was almost, it was like, it's a bit too much for me. Like, 1 or 2 is fine, but there were quite a lot. Like, it's quite a sexual show, which I still like the show, but it's not exactly what I wanted, especially as I was watching it at home and then like worried that someone's gonna come in and be like, what are you watching? And I just prefer watching a show that I could watch and people can walk in and not, and I wouldn't feel embarrassed, you know? And I would kind of feel embarrassed with Elite. But yes, I really enjoyed season 1. I thought it was done really well. I thought the cinematography, the storytelling, the characters, the plot, all of that was really, really good. And then I saw that they were bringing out season 2, and I was a bit worried, because I thought season 1 was so good. I thought, how are they gonna replicate this, when kind of the whole point of season 1 was who killed this person? And then it gets answered by the end of season 1. So I was kind of like, well, where do we go from here? But I actually think season 2 was really, really good. I really, really enjoyed it. It kind of took the formula of season 1, but even like elevated it somehow. And I really, really enjoyed it. I really love season 2. And then I remember liking season 3 and then maybe season 4 if I've seen it. But I do think it did suffer a decline, a drop off, just because some of the main characters went away. Some of the main characters made some questionable decisions that I just don't think they would have ever done, and all this stuff. But yeah, I do really like Elite, and I do want to finish the series because I'm not up to date. But Elite is at my number 9 spot. And at number 8, we have the show Heartstopper. Sitting close on the table, wanting more from the neighbor. I was in love with you. When we were young, we were young, we were young, we were young. I want to believe in romance. Season 1 of Heartstopper, I loved it so much. I just found it, I don't know, I just thought it was the cutest thing I'd ever seen in my life. I just thought it was adorable, and I really, really enjoyed it. Yeah, Heartstopper 1, very, very good. I watched it, and then I was like to my boyfriend, we should watch this together. So we watched season 1 together, and then we watched season 2 together. And I believe season 3 is either coming out soon or is out now, I'm not sure, but we'll definitely be watching that together. Yeah, I just love it. I think it's a really good story, it's an important story, and it's just really nice. I will say though, watching season two, I was excited for it to come back, but I didn't enjoy it as much. And I think season two for me really revealed just how childish this show is, which is fine and not an insult, because I think this show is for teens and tweens. Like, I'm not the target audience. I don't think adults are the target audience, but I think season one felt maybe a little bit more grown up, and then season two just really, yeah, felt a bit childish to me, which is again not a problem because I think it's for the intended audience. So I think just as I'm watching it, I'm realizing that maybe it's not for me, but I still really like it. It's a good show. Characters are great. Yeah, it's a good time. It's a good plot. It's important stories, nice cinematography, all of that stuff. The actors are really good as well. But yeah, I do worry that because we had season one, which I did really enjoy. Season two was also good. But as I said, I just kind of realized, I don't know if this show is for me, basically. I worry now that there's going to be another season, that it's going to fall in the trap of what I like to call as too much of a good thing, which is where you get a show where it has like the first season that's so good and does so well that you're like, well, we have to make another one. You make a season two, which is good, but it inevitably has a decline in quality just because it's really hard to replicate perfection, essentially. And then you just keep making more. And with every season, you have a decline in quality. And I think this has happened to a lot of shows, unfortunately. And I don't want it to happen to Heartstopper, but I feel like it might. And it's one of those things where like a TV show becomes not a narrative anymore, it becomes content. Like, it's like, we got to churn the next season out. And yeah, I don't know, maybe like, it's like content fatigue, like all this stuff. I just worry that that is what the trap that it's going to fall into. Hopefully not, fingers crossed. But I just know that season three coming around felt so soon to be. Even though it hadn't actually, it had been a while since season two, but it did feel so soon that I thought, oh, we're back already. We're ready for the next season. Like, yeah, I don't know. But it is the number eight spot on this list because I do really enjoy it. And season one was just so good. Like, yeah, I'll rewatch season one over and over because it was just so cute and I really, really enjoyed it. Then at number seven, we have a show that's a little bit of a different speed, and this is Derry Girls.
She smirked!
Hey, bye, Gam. This is the best thing that's ever happened to me. Can't say it that way!
Enough! And you just sat there and said, sweet Fanny Adams?
Your grandma said Fanny.
So Derry Girls is a comedy set in Ireland, I believe in like, set in the 90s, I believe. And yeah, Derry Girls is so funny. It's just really great. It's just this group of Irish girls who are going about their life, and they get a boy who joins their gang as well. And it's just about them living their life while also under basically like English army occupation. So like the English army are there because of like the IRA and stuff. And like, yeah, but it tries to, you know, make light of these situations, but then it does also have a serious aspect and tone to it that comes across in some episodes, which I do like when that comes across as well. But yeah, just a really, really fun show, easy watch, and mainly female characters, which is really, really nice. So Derry Girls is at my number seven spot. Number six, we have The Crown.
What does one have to do to get some kindness in this family?
In time, she will give up her fight and bend, as they all do.
And if she doesn't bend, what then?
She will break.
A very different show to Derry Girls. But we have The Crown, and I'm sure most people have heard of The Crown, but The Crown is essentially a show that is kind of chronicling the English monarchy from when Queen Elizabeth became queen to it ends with essentially around when Diana died. So it's from that point. And yeah, I love The Crown. I found it really interesting. I didn't really know much about our monarchy, because obviously I'm English, so it is literally like my country's history and stuff, and I didn't know much about it. Never really been that interested, to be honest, but it was really interesting learning about it, learning about why we have a monarchy and like the belief system behind it and all this stuff. Like, very, very interesting. Yeah, I found season one to be very beautiful. The cinematography is really nice, and the story is really interesting because it's all about Elizabeth becoming queen. It's about her dad passing away and all this stuff. And yeah, I thought it was done really, really well. I think each season is about 10 episodes, and each episode concentrates usually on one kind of thing in history. And yeah, it was really interesting. It was crazy to think that, I think it's in season one, that Churchill is there. I don't know why, but it just feels like Churchill is so old. Like, it's so weird to think about, like, Churchill and the Queen, like, having tea together. Like, it's so weird to me. But they did, and, like, that was a real thing. Yeah, a really, really good show. I do think the best season of the show is it season four? I think it's season four is the season where Charles is of age. He's come of age. I think he might even be like 28 or something. And it's when he meets Diana and they start the whole romance and then get married. I think that is the best season. I think it's so good. And I think it is mainly down to, well, the story is really good. It's really interesting. But I think it is down to the actors, Emma Corrin and Josh O'Connor as Charles and Diana. Just did so good, and I do really think that's the best season. That's like the pinnacle for me, that season. But then season one is also really good because it's like, I don't know, it's like the foundations of everything, and it's the base. And I knew nothing about like the Queen's dad, for example, but then they have me there like sobbing at the fact that he's passed away, and it's like, I don't know this man. I never knew this man. Yeah, it's a really good show. It's very, very interesting. I do think, following that same trap that I was talking about of too much of a good thing, it kind of suffered a bit from that, but also not, because it was just recounting history, and obviously there was more history to go over. But yeah, I think the last season definitely fell in quality. It's funny me saying this because I still haven't even finished the last season. I think I've only got like 3 episodes left though, so I'm not far off, but I do think it has kind of fallen in quality, unfortunately, but still a very, very good show. And fun fact, I actually know one of the creators of the show. Well, no is an interesting way to put it. He's the brother of a woman who works for my dad's company, or works, she's now retired. But yeah, so I have some connection there, which is cool. But yeah, I really, really like The Crown, and that is why it is at number 6. Now at number 5, we have, again, switching up the tone so much, we have Peep Show.
Where's the turkey, Jeremy?
What? The turkey, where's the turkey?
You cretin!
All right, Mark, give us 10, would you?
What? I didn't know.
Didn't know what?
Nothing. What? I don't know. Is there a problem?
You let Superhands use my bed for... Bill!
Peep Show is a comedy, and it just follows two guys as they navigate life, essentially, in London, in a flat in London. And Peep Show has a very interesting concept because it's a show where you see from the character's perspective. So you see their perspective, so you can like imagine you're seeing through their eyes. They recorded it in that way, and so you're a character looking at another character, which is really interesting. And I think it all just plays really well into the comedy, because the Peep Show is a comedy, and it's very, very funny. It's a dark comedy, very dark humor, and I love it so much. It's so good. Yeah, just a great show. Great show. So easily bingeable, very quotable, just really good, very enjoyable. Yeah, I really, really like Peep Show. Number 4, we're getting into the higher ranked shows now, and at number 4, we have one that I love so much. We have Peaky Blinders.
My name is Thomas Shelby.
Thomas!
In France, I got used to seeing men die.
What is it you do?
Oh, I do bad things. This is our city.
By order of the Peaky Blinders.
It is Tommy that has brought strength and power to this family.
Tommy Shelby, MP.
I promised someone I'd change the world.
I love Peaky Blinders so much. I did start watching it quite late. I started watching it in lockdown, so in 2020, and I believe it started, I don't even know, maybe like 2016 or something. Like, it started quite before that, but I just never watched it. It didn't really appeal to me. And then I started watching it and was like, what? Why did I never watch this? This is so good. And Cillian Murphy is so hot. And that's where my Cillian Murphy obsession really took a hold. I'd always known of him and found him very attractive, but watching him in Peaky Blinders was like, oh my god, like, you are just the most attractive human being I've ever seen in my life, basically. Yeah, it's just such a good show as well. It's a very interesting story, very well written, very well acted. Just 10 out of 10 all around. So good. I'm sure everyone knows, but if you don't know, Peaky Blinders is about a gang in Birmingham, and it is set like around the 1920s after the First World War. And it's about a gang called the Peaky Blinders and about what they get up to in trying to maintain the hold that they have over their area, trying to gain power, gang wars, different clashes with the police, with the Irish, with travelers, all this stuff. Yeah, that's Peaky Blinders. It's so good, and I'm so happy that, in my opinion, the final season was good, because I think when you have a show that good, the ending, it's so hard to end it. I think it's so hard to end it and end it well, and end it and make people feel satisfied, like the fans feel satisfied. I mean, we just look at Game of Thrones, and like, you can see how things can really go wrong. So I was really worried for season 6 of Peaky Blinders, especially, which is the final season, especially as I did not enjoy season 5 as much. So I thought, oh no, this is just going to be another decline in quality. I'm going to be sad. And watching season 6, as it was going, I was not really liking it. I was thinking, I'm not gelling with this. But then by the end, when you see what happens at the end and you have the payoff, I think it's so good. I think it was the best ending possible for this show. And I know there's going to be a movie, which I'm very excited for, but then I'm also really scared that it's going to suck. I hope not. I mean, they've released that Barry Keoghan is going to be in it, which I am very excited about because I love him as well. And I think it makes so much sense for him to be in there, considering he got one of his starts in the show Love and Hate, which is like about gangs in Ireland, but set modern day. And now this is gangs in Birmingham, but I'm sure he'll be Irish. I feel like if he's not Irish in the movie, that's gonna be really weird. Yeah, I don't know why they wouldn't make him Irish, but hopefully they will. But I am really worried. But I know there's a movie, but I do think if the show ended where it ended, it's really good. I think it was a really good end, and I was very happy when I watched that final episode. And I'm gonna spoil it here, so if you don't want to know, move on. But I just have to talk about it because it was just so iconic. But essentially, the whole season, Tommy Shelby, who is our main character played by Cillian Murphy, thinks that he is dying. He gets told by his doctor that he's dying. He keeps having all these symptoms of kind of like a brain tumor. Essentially, he keeps having all these symptoms that are synonymous with a brain tumor, so he really thinks he's gonna die. And in the last episode, he goes off in his like wagon, I don't know what to call it, wagon, to die, basically, to just be there and just die in the countryside in peace. And now this is like a context dump, basically, but I'm going to tell it to you with like minimal context. His daughter essentially like comes to him from the grave to tell him, like, you're not going to die, like, you're not dying. And essentially what he finds out is that his doctor has been paid off to tell him that he's dying when he's not. And also, I think he went to this wagon in the middle of nowhere to shoot himself. So like, you know, to die, to like finish it instead of ending in a long, drawn out suffering. He just wants to shoot himself and like, it's over type thing. But he finds out right before he's gonna do it that his doctor has been paid off by a man who's essentially his, like, by a man who's working against him. And then, so he doesn't kill himself, and he goes and he, I don't know if he kills the guy, but I think he definitely kills the doctor. Being like, why'd you make me think I was gonna die? But I really, really liked this. I thought it was actually a really good ending. I'm glad that he didn't die, and it doesn't make sense that he would die like Tommy Shelby, because there's going to be a movie. So I kind of, while I was watching it, I kind of thought, but there's going to be a movie. What? Well, you can't die. I didn't really know where it was going. But yeah, so he doesn't die. And I really like the whole idea that, like, I think one of the doctor says it, or like someone else says it, they really wanted to kill Tommy Shelby because he's like this powerful man, and they wanted to kill him. And they were saying the only man who could kill Tommy Shelby is Tommy Shelby. And I just love that. I'm like, that's true. And you tried, but you failed. Yeah, I really, really liked that ending. I thought it was just perfect, to be honest, for the show. There were things that have happened in the show that I was not happy about, but we move and we keep our hopes up for the movie, that it will be good and that they will get Tom Hardy back as Alfie, because I think some of the best scenes are between Tommy and Alfie. Like that scene where Tommy like screams at Alfie saying that he's crossed the line. That's one of my favourite scenes ever. That's so good. Yeah, so that is Peaky Blinders. And in place number three, we have one that is another international one, and this is the show Scam.
Danska bøger.
Fy faen!
Hva er det?
Jeg har aldri sett bildet Magnus Lata på Instagram.
Se på han! Å fy faen, Eva! Virkelig, liksom.
Hva er det du har på deg?
Specifically the Norwegian Scam, so the original, I'm pretty sure that's the original. So Scam is a show basically just all about these teens at secondary school and their life and what happens. And it's in Norway, and essentially I think it was Tumblr how people found out about it, but essentially Scam became incredibly popular all around the world, and essentially teen girls all around the world were watching it and loving it. Like I was here in England and heard about it and started watching it and loved it so much. I think it is such a good show. It is so well done, it's so well made, the characters are so good, the drama is amazing. Yeah, I love Scam so much, and because of the success of Scam, they then remade it for loads of different countries. I don't know if there's an English Scam. I don't know. I feel like if there is, it would suck, but I don't know if there is. But I know there's like Italian Scam, Spanish Scam, probably a French Scam. Yeah, really, like, it's just crazy. Like, it just shows the influence that it had, that all these countries were like, we're gonna replicate that in our own language, where they basically take the characters and the story and remake it, but in their language, because Scam is in Norwegian. But yeah, the original Scam has my heart. It's so good. I've never actually watched any of the other ones. I would like to, just because I really like Scam so much. I don't think they're gonna be as good as the original, but I would like to watch them. And yeah, I just love Scam so much. It's just such a good show. To me, it's just so many memories of being a teen and watching that and just loving it. Waiting like for the new episode to come out that week and then watching it was, yeah. I just love Scam. It's very, very good. That's why it's in my number three place. Now, finally, we have the final two TV shows. Now, these two are kind of interchangeable, but I do think I have put them in order, and I do think this order is correct, but it's hard because they both, like, I care about both these shows the same amount, like, as each other. Like, I don't really prefer one over the other. They're both, I love them both the same because they both touched me so much, even though they are very different shows, I think, but I love them both. So let's just do the order. Number two, we have Normal People.
I feel nothing for you. Nothing.
Why are you saying this?
Her new boyfriend is more in line with her social class.
Are you dating anyone problematic at the moment?
I haven't had a midnight call from you in a while. So corrupt and sexy.
Would you say your feelings are involved?
Obviously.
Who is it obvious to?
Well, I'm sure everyone's heard about Normal People, but it's about two Irish teens and about their relationship, them trying to have a relationship when they're both terrible at communication and always miscommunicate, and just, yeah, it's just watching them do that for, like, I don't know, what is it, 4 years, like, just watching them miscommunicate. It's based on the novel by Sally Rooney, which is a very good novel that I do enjoy. I do think I prefer the show to the novel. I did like the novel, but I watched the show first, which maybe is where I went wrong. And the show, yeah, I don't know, seeing it come to life is just, it feels better for me. I just love it. Yeah, Normal People, so good. It's where Paul Mescal and Daisy got their starts, and yeah, it's just so good. It's so good. It came out in lockdown, I think, and I remember, like, everyone watching it and just it being a massive hit, and I watched it and I just loved it so much. And then I got my boyfriend to watch it because I was like, this is so good that anyone would love this. We watched it together and he loved it, and it's just so good. And just a few highlights, I do have a video about Normal People on my channel, like an older one called Why I Love Normal People, so I do go more into all of it. But just a few, like, little highlights of bits that I remember that I just loved so much was Connell's whole storyline of, like, going to uni and, like, really struggling. That hit me hard because I was the same. Like, I loved my uni experience by the end, and I'm so happy I went and, like, had a great time. But the beginning was very hard. Like, I was probably the most depressed I'd ever been in my life, so I found that very relatable. And anytime those bits come on, I would just cry my eyes out. And yeah, when I rewatched it with my boyfriend, he was like, are you okay? Because I was just sobbing my eyes out. But yeah, such a beautiful show. So good. I love the characters of Marianne and Connell so much. I see myself in both of them, and I see my boyfriend in Connell so much. Like, they are so similar. It's such a good show. Love Normal People so much. I'm going to rewatch it. I feel like I'm going to rewatch it soon, because even just thinking about it, I feel like I want to cry. I just love it so much. It's just so good. It's so good. And I also feel like it's one of those shows, along with the one that is number one that will be revealed in due course, I feel like it's one of those shows that you can just rewatch and rewatch and rewatch, but at different stages in your life, and at every different stage you will learn something new. I feel like it's one of those ones so much, because I think it's one of those shows that dissects human relationships and behaviors. And I think, yeah, at every different age you'll be able to see different things because you're at a different stage, and I think that is so beautiful. So I watched it the first time when I was 20, second time I must have been 21, and I definitely picked up different things, even though it was only a year's difference. Definitely picked up different things. I'm now 24, so I would love to rewatch it and see what I get out of it, because I'm sure it will be different to what I got out of it then. Yeah, that is Normal People. And finally, in the number one spot, we have one of my most beloved shows, as Normal People is, but I have put this at number one, and this is Fleabag.
You close with your family?
Is that fur?
Yes, but it's okay because it had a stroke.
Lovely.
We get on with it.
I thought you'd be in prison, but no.
Oh, well, keep trying, but they just won't have me.
Don't be yourself.
Oh my God!
I won't.
So Fleabag is the comedy created by Phoebe Waller-Bridge. It was actually originally a play, a one-woman play, which was essentially just a big monologue of her sat on this chair, which I have seen. I saw it at the cinema because they did a run where it was like National Theatre Live. Sort of my mum. The play is a bit more brutal than the show. Like, the play shocked me quite a lot, but I do think that is kind of the nature of plays, because they, especially with a play like Fleabag, they're not visually showing you what she is doing, she's just describing it, whereas in a show you see it, and I feel like that can be a bit harder to watch type thing. Yes, Fleabag is a comedy about a woman essentially just trying to figure stuff out. So her best friend passed away recently, her mum's passed away, she has tumultuous relationships with her dad and her sister and her stepmum, and she's just trying to navigate life essentially. And yeah, she's trying to navigate life and love, and she does it in a hilarious way, and I love it so much. And I put it above Normal People just because it has two seasons, so there's more. So I'm like, It gave me more, so therefore it gets to go number one. And season two, I love season one so much. I think it's so good. But season two, you get the hot priest introduced, who is Andrew Scott. And I've had a long time crush on Andrew Scott since Sherlock. What a man. You get him as the hot priest, which just, for me, elevates the show so much. And I love it. I love it so much. Fleabag is such a good show. I'd recommend it to anyone. My boyfriend has yet to watch it, and I definitely need to rectify that, because what the hell? He needs to watch it. But yeah, such a good show. And again, like Normal People, it's a show that I think I can rewatch and get something new every time. And it's also just hilarious. Like, it is hilarious. It's so funny. Also has its tender, you know, more serious moments, but it is so funny. And I love it for that. And that is it for my top 10 favourite international/English TV shows that I have seen so far. Hope you enjoyed. Hope you got some new recommendations. Yeah, I really want to rewatch Fleabag and Normal People right now. But that's the end of the video. Bye. I know I said that was the end of the video, but I just have to interject here. Because it's not, because while editing this video, I realised I forgot about a British TV show that I love so much, and I just completely forgot because I watched it a few years ago. Well, I watched it when I was a teen, but I did rewatch it actually with my boyfriend, who also loved it, and I rewatched it with my mum as well. So I've watched it a total of probably about 5 times, and I just completely forgot about it. So I'm putting it in here now, and the TV show is My Mad Fat Diary. My Mad Fat Diary is so good. Yeah, it's so good, and I feel like I would honestly put it 3 or 4 on the list. Like, that's how much I loved it. It's so entertaining. The story is so fun. It's a comedy. It's about this girl called Ray in, I believe, the 90s, who's struggling to fit in, struggling to make friends, and she's just spent the whole of summer in a mental institution because she probably has depression and has a few issues that she's trying to work through. And she essentially hates herself, and it's a show all about her navigating that as a teen. And there's 3 seasons, and it's just so good. It's so good. It's 10 out of 10. So I had to add it on at the end here before I end this video, because I could not talk about British TV shows that I love without talking about My Mad Fat Diary, because it is so good and definitely worth the watch. But that is the actual ending of the video now. Thanks for watching. Bye.